I don't know, smashed a grapefruit, let alone a fly, let alone killed a person. He does not, which speaks well of his character. He was in a TV show in the 60s called The Saint.
Yeah.
Great show. Excellent. He is excellent in that film because The Saint is a smart jewel thief who is witty, does all the stuff that Bond does in the movies, except he doesn't have to kill anybody.
He drives a Volvo.
He tries to get out of fights. He doesn't even want to have fisticuffs, let alone kill somebody. So, and this is less Roger Moore than the direction they took it in. They went to make it campier, funnier. They went for big action sequences, but less. There's still a lot of violence in the film, but it's no longer believable. Absolutely unbelievable to me, which is why I think all of the Roger Moore films, they would have been fun films if they were something other than James Bond films. Some of them would suck no matter what they were.
I might put in the good category. We'll get to that in a minute. But
yeah, Live and Let Die is a meh to me.
It's a Bond film.
Yeah.
How about The Man with the Golden Gun?
Same thing. It's a meh film.
It's a Bond film.
And Christopher Lee, pretty freaking great villain, but he's not that well used.
And this is his third nipple.
Yeah, he's not that well used in this film. He's Christopher freaking Lee. So underwritten. Let's put it that way.
The next one was The Spy Who Loved Me, which I think could have been one of the best Bond films, but they added Jaws.
Yeah.
Who was just, I'm sorry, that's too silly. Yep. I can't take it seriously anymore.
Exactly. Way over the top.
And he didn't need to be. It was uncalled for.
They really didn't need that in there. Even without the addition of Jaws, which is just a fun character, but it's like he should have been in a Saturday morning cartoon, for God's sakes.
Yeah.
To me, that's still just, it's a Bond film.
See, that was then followed up with we want to make a Star Wars film with Bond in it, Moonraker.
Yeah.
And this is where things start to go horribly wrong, because to me, Jaws was in this one, but he made it better. And if Jaws is making your film better, you've gone horrifically wrong.
Yes. When the henchman is one of the most popular parts of the previous film, you got problems.
You've done something horribly wrong. Thing is, and this confused me. They followed it with For Your Eyes Only, which to me was the best Roger Moore film. Do you have an opinion on that one way or the other? Or
my opinion on all the Roger Moore films are they are trash and utter crap. The only reason I'm saying they're okay, that it's a Bond film, is because they're fun to watch and blah, blah, blah. But I haven't watched a Roger Moore Bond film in probably 15 years because they pissed me off so much, because they went in such a terrible direction. They have such awful special effects. I mean, for the time, they have terrible special effects. I don't remember which one it is because I refuse to watch the damn things again. But there's one where he's underwater, and the Bond girl is underwater with them. And they clearly filmed it in with some fans, because the way their hair is blowing is clearly in the wind, not in the water. They didn't even bother putting them in the water. They faked it because I guess it was going to cost too much to rent a swimming pool, or Roger Moore didn't feel like getting wet. It's like, how utterly crappy. They did such a terrible job of carrying this license to make money that they absolutely ran the freaking thing into the ground. Some of those movies, and we haven't gotten to them yet, some of those are absolutely awful films, and we will get to them. But for me, all of them suck. All of the Roger Moore films suck because, and again, Roger Moore could have done a better job if they had written them better. Not that I ever could buy him as like an assassin to begin with, but they went so far in the direction of, let's make this fun and campy and have shitty effects. It's like, it's clear that they didn't even care anymore. And I mean, the producers, that it sure didn't show up on screen.
Well, that brings us quite nicely to Never Say Never Again.
Yes.
Oh, look, Sean Connery's back, but he's got this other group of writers. And this one, to me, this one is another one of those, yeah, it's a Bond film.
Right.
But it's because I think they tried to make Connery into Roger Moore for this film, which, please, do it the other way. But they didn't.
Yeah, he comes back out of retirement. And so he's an older Bond. So there's concessions to his age, which is hilarious considering how long he would play action heroes. Hello, Alan Quatermain. Yep. And like you said, this was not an authorized Bond film. Despite the fact that he's playing James Bond. And basically, this is a remake of Thunderball. It's the same plot as Thunderball. Yeah.
It has a video game in the middle of it.
Yeah, not as well done as Thunderball. Directed by the guy who directed one of, I think most people would say one of the best movies ever, The Empire Strikes Back. So there you go. Irvin Kershner directed this as well. Really good Bond villain. Really good Bond girl. Really good Bond.
But really impressive horse.
But it still winds up just being it's a Bond movie.
It's a Bond film, as opposed to the film that came out a whopping 2 months later.
Yeah.
which would be another Bond film, this one licensed. Octopussy.
Yeah.
Are we putting this one in the, why did you make that a Bond film?
Yeah, this is a big no.
And then they followed that with 1985's A View to a Kill, which I will, in my opinion, and I'm going to go off on this someday, had the best Bond theme. In my opinion, and I'll get to that someday, and they wasted it on the worst Bond film. There is not a worse Bond film to me than that. They had Grace Jones, who could have been a great bad guy. They had Christopher Walken, who could have been a great bad guy. And they had, I have lost his name, the guy from the Avengers, the original Patrick McNee.
Yeah, that's him, Patrick McNee.
I'll get there eventually. I'm slow, but there. Had all these great people in it. And wrote a crap fest.
Yes.
So, to me, that's squarely in the, don't watch this one.
The beginning is fun.
The beginning is fun, but when you have a chase scene with a fire truck.
Yeah.
And
there's a problem when the best scene in the movie happens before they even roll the opening credits.
I think we're going to get to that in another one farther down the list. But mercifully, that was the last Roger Moore film, because now we're on to Timothy Dalton.
Yes, we are.
And let's see, The Living Daylights in 87, License to Kill in 89. And you know what? I liked both of them. But I'm not sure that we can put them in the same category as Connery's.
No, not at all.
Or can we? Are they...
Nope. Nope.
Are they close, or are these just both? Yep, they were Bond films.
They're Bond films to me. They're entertaining. They're worth watching. It's like, they're out at the theater. Let's go watch a Bond movie. And you'll come home and you'll say, yeah, that was a good Bond movie. But to me, that's all you're getting out of it.
So I guess we're moving on to,
They're almost good by default, because it's not Roger Moore and it's not right. The super's idiotic slapstick crap that they had turned the Bond films into anymore. They were actually trying to make, this is about a guy who kills people for the British government.
And I think they did a good job of it. It's just not Connery.
Right.
Which brings us to Pierce Brosnan, who was almost revered as Connery-esque, or supposed to be Connery the Next Generation. And I think they started good with I think GoldenEye. I want to put that in the category with Connery's.
I will put it in the category of not with Connery's, but I will put it in the category of these are really good. That's a really good film.
Put it above just it's more than just a Bond film.
Yeah, exactly. It goes in with the really good Bond films. I agree. And Brosnan is interesting to me because, to me, they clearly said, let's get the best of Connery and let's get the best of Moore, you know, the easygoing humor and stuff, which actually Connery had even better than Moore, but whatever. So, and we'll combine those. So we'll have the humor. So they're going to be more humorous than the Connery films. And Brosnan can totally pull that off. And Brosnan, at the same time, can play someone who actually appears to be dangerous. So that worked off. Not to me, not as well as Connery, but it was a vast improvement over Moore and an improvement over Dalton. Dalton was good, but I think they had refound range here of what they were trying to do with Bond films. Not to the level of the early Connery stuff, but I think they had realized, oh, okay, this finally looks like a Bond film instead of like, it's a Bond movie.
Now, the next two confused me a bit. 97's Tomorrow Never Dies and 99's The World Is Not Enough. But what confused me about these is the titles are switched. Because the first one, Tomorrow Never Dies, is about a guy who wants to take over the world and the world is not enough for him. Mm-hmm. And the next one is about a guy who doesn't die.
Yeah.
So if you switch the titles back to what I think they should have been, I'd put them above, you know, the meh, they're a Bond film. I think they were good films. I don't know that they were up to Connery, though.
To me, they're both just meh, they're Bond movies. To me, they're also almost completely interchangeable, except Tomorrow Never Dies has Michelle Yeoh.
Yeah.
That is a big standout. And that's one of the few times when they actually said, oh, let's get a female lead who can hold her own with Bond. That makes sense. But they are so interchangeable. I absolutely could not tell you what happens in either one. They're just...
I have to look them up every time.
Yeah.
And go, all right, which one was which?
Which you don't have that problem with those, with the, any of the Connery films, let alone the first three.
Yeah. So, and I guess Die Another Day. There were issues with Die Another Day, but it are they as bad as some of the Roger Moore films?
No. This is, to me, this is another, it's a Bond movie. It's a
Bond film. So that brings us up to the current Bond. And no, we have not reviewed No Time to Die because it's not out yet. Damn you. Where are you putting Daniel Craig in all this?
Daniel Craig, to me, is the first person who actually plays James Bond correctly. That's since Connery, that is. Obviously, part of that is script, part of that is direction, but a big part of it is Daniel Craig. Daniel Craig, in the films, does he look like someone who could calmly walk up to someone, shoot them in the head, and not even blink?
Not even stop? Just not even really look at them? Just keep going?
Take another drink, play another hand of Baccarat? I mean, absolutely, he pulls this off. Without question, and I can't imagine anyone arguing that there has been a better Bond since Connery than Daniel Craig. Miles better than Brosnan, Dalton, Lazenberry, Lazenby, not Burry, sorry, George.
Lazenberries, that's a new flavor from Captain Crunch.
Oh my God, that'd be so good. Tastes like murder. And of course, Roger Moore. I like Roger Moore as an actor. He's just totally wrong for the Bond films. But Craig is terrific. Craig may actually be more physical than Connery, which is saying something. Because Connery was a freaking beast. And yeah. Craig just, the physicality of the role, and again, this is the way they shot the films and the way they were written. It's not just Craig. But they could have put a lot of actors in the role and it wouldn't have worked. Craig is absolutely terrific. Connery is still my favorite Bond, but I can totally see someone younger who starts with the Daniel Craig films and then goes back to Connery, and they're saying, yeah, Connery's really good, but Craig is Bond. I can absolutely see that.
So where are we putting
Casino Royale, absolutely.